My name is Trent Tate, and I would like to introduce you to DVDT. We are here to take you through our Capstone Design Experience, where we successfully designed, developed, tested, and delivered a satellite communication system to our customer. We will show you firsthand the steps taken that accelerated DVDT in completing this space project. I would like to introduce the team. DVDT consists of Dakota Kerr, the hardware engineer, Vince Rodriguez, the software engineer, David Smith, the systems integration engineer, and Trent Tate, the project manager. T-Star came to DVDT with the idea of making space exploration more accessible to the public. And we really liked that idea. So we chose this project based on that we really liked the idea, and also because the customers we're working with T-Star, with Dr. Morgan, we really enjoyed working with these people and have experience working with them in the past. And so it made sense for us to go forward with this project. The first step in making space exploration more accessible is going to the nearest orbit to us, which is low Earth orbit. And so T-Star was working towards the idea of CubeSats. These are nano satellites that would be launched into low Earth orbit, and they would orbit the Earth and just collect data, host experiments, take pictures, temperature readings, atmospheric data, lots of things to study the Earth. This is the first step in exploring space. And so T-Star was going with this idea, and they are working on their project called the TSat. And so T-Star came to DVDT because they needed help in developing the TSat. DVDT really liked the idea of the TSat, but there was a lot of things we did not know about this market, about this industry. You know, how do we start with this project? So DVDT did a lot of research where we were reading lots of things online, watching videos, talking with our customer to understand what is this system going to be doing? What is the problem we're trying to solve?
You'll never be able to fully complete your project if you don't understand what your project is. That's why communicating effectively with your customer is so important, because they have an idea in their mind what it is that they want developed, and you have a completely different image.
So the major problem that we were trying to solve that T-Star came to us for was that their T-Sat needed a communication system, okay? So the T-Sat is orbiting the Earth, it's collecting data, but all that data is on the T-Sat still. It needs to be sent down to the Earth. And so the T-Sat was missing that system. The T-Sat has an existing system in it called the missile stack, and this was actually already been developed by NASA. And so what we were doing is building the communication system that stacked onto that missile stack. So we're integrating with existing architecture. So for example, the missile stack already has a power layer, which powers everything. It already has an intelligence layer, which has all the data, which is where the T-Sat will hold its data. And then it's missing a communication layer, which is what we're going to build to integrate with this existing NASA architecture so that we can send that data from the intelligence layer out of our layer down to an Earth station. So there's a lot of different factors that we had to go into in designing the hardware and the software. Once we had a great understanding of our problem, you know, we drew drawings. We had a conceptual block diagram that showed their system in blocks. What needs to be in here to make this system work? What are these subsections that make this work? You know, we have power. We have to power a device. We have to have intelligence. We have to send data out. We have to have a transceiver or a radio. And so there's these different blocks that we understood, okay, this is how this whole system is going to work as like a body.
We didn't know exactly what was going to be in those subsections, but we understood that we needed them for the design of our system, and we were able to then narrow down our research into the chipsets and functionalities that we needed.
We had to research a lot of devices that are going to fulfill, you know, those conceptual blocks we put in there. You know, what is going to make that block function? What circuit is going to be in there?
Now this is where our engineering problem solving came into play. For example, with our communications chipset, we needed to analyze the pros and cons and assess and make these trade-offs between price, functionality, and support. In the end, we ended up making our decision based off the support provided by TI, since they had the largest supporting staff, and we knew we could get any questions we had from a technical standpoint answered.
It's very wise to choose devices from companies that have a good supporting staff on that device, because you're gonna have a lot of questions on how this works. So you need forums and you need online, you need a company that's very responsive. And so luckily we had TI who was, you know, would answer our questions on our transceiver within a couple of hours after asking a question. So having that support is what really helped us in our designing and to really ensure success whenever the actual PCB came in.
After we knew which devices were going to be in each subsection, we moved on to our functional block diagram, which we used between the hardware and software engineer to effectively communicate with one another and understand from a pin level what we're going to be doing and how we're going to design our system.
As you go through your Capstone experience, you know, you're going to make your conceptual block diagram, you're going to make your functional block diagram. While making those, always be thinking about how software is going to be interfacing with this. So if you know you have a lot of analog inputs, you know, how is your microcontroller going to handle those, and how are you going to be able to handle that with your software? So in our system, we use an RTOS for primarily the reason that our system is very time critical. So we only have a short window of time where we can send information down to the Earth station. So we want to make sure that during that time, we're sending as much information as we can down. So by using an RTOS, we can create scheduling and we can do tasks that allow us to send this information down to Earth as quickly as possible.
One thing I did to set us up for success in hardware was work through numerous YouTube tutorials. I did this by working through a complete project and laying out the schematic and board layout for a switching regulator before even beginning to work on our design.
So oftentimes in Capstone, software kind of falls behind and it causes projects to be delayed. And so I think this is accredited to software not being worked on earlier. So oftentimes we work on hardware, we do our board layouts, we do our layout reviews, and we get the board ordered, but during that time, not a lot of software development is taking place. And so with our team, we made sure that we ordered evaluation kits. We ordered all the necessary components so that software could be worked on and being developed in parallel with hardware. Start looking at code, start generating something that turns an LED on and off. You know, as simple as that, it gets you comfortable in the environment that you're gonna be writing your code in. It gets you comfortable in writing whatever language.
One big mistake that most hardware engineers will make is diving straight into the schematic. At DVDT, what we did was utilize many reference designs, so we weren't reinventing the wheel. And then we looked at our schematic and said, how do we want to lay this out so that we understand and can communicate this effectively with our reader or potential people that are helping us in the future understand what it is that we're trying to communicate through our schematic? Because that's exactly what the schematic is for.
Capstone is setting you up for your career. And so this is helping you to learn, you know, how to be professional, how to treat your teammates professionally, and to be responsive and accountable to each other to get work done. And so that was something that DVDT did very well in. We all worked in the same lab together. We all worked in missile labs or DVDT headquarters. And that's where we all worked together and made sure we were all on the same page on where this is going. It's important to plan your vision on where you want to go with this project and what time frame. And so DVDT had a big calendar that we'd write down, you know, what's coming up and how long has this been taking us, so we needed this many days to get to here. And we would set kind of a vision for the next month, you know, where do we need to be to get these things done so we could plan ahead. Okay, this weekend let's be here because we need to work on this.
DVDT was on an accelerated path. And to accomplish that goal, we knew we needed to make a number of sacrifices, such as working over Christmas break in order to have our alpha PCB ready by the beginning of our Capstone 2 semester.
Whenever you're doing your designs and really when you're preparing anything for Capstone, it's very important that you're not doing it alone. You need someone to be double checking everything. And so we did that, for example, during our layout. We had a layout checklist that we went through and we checked all of these pins, we checked all these requirements of our layout to make sure everything was mapped correctly, make sure everything was laid out correctly. Because, you know, doing it by yourself and not getting anyone to check on it, it's very likely there's going to be errors. And so you need to have that person who's going to step in and review everything to make sure it's ready for the next step.
One thing DVDT learned is that industry does make mistakes. We got the phone call that our alpha boards were ready after population and we were ecstatic. We were ready to test and move on in our project. And then when we were driving back, we realized that one of the chips was soldered incorrectly, and we had already waited 10 days. Now this was earth-shattering because we didn't know if we were going to move on with our project, if our thing was going to work, and we didn't know if we were going to be delayed an additional 10 days. The moral of that story is, in project management, you need to lay out time for things like this to occur because industry isn't always perfect.
When the Alpha Board first came in, it was probably one of the most stressful days of DVDT's lives. We came in, you know, we had the boards, we had to populate them, so Dakota had to hand solder all the components.
We had about 60 0402 components in an inch by inch square, which is typically only done by machines.
You know, software was ready. I had tested it on the evaluation kits. It worked. So we were all ready. Once the board was populated by Dakota, we brought it together.
We're beginning to do our final integration of our Alpha board and testing with our actual software. Now this was the scariest part of the whole experience because nothing had ever worked yet and we were on the cusp of validating our system, and then nothing worked.
We put it on a missile stack, it fit correctly, flipped the switch, and it didn't transfer packets.
And that was incredibly hard.
It kind of hit us. You know, this is a important project. Our graduation's dependent on it. You know, T-Star really needs us to pursue their idea of space exploration. And so, it wasn't that fun that day.
We didn't know, was it hardware, was it software? If it was hardware, were we gonna have to wait 4 more weeks and redesign our board and have it remanufactured?
It's important, whenever you hit a roadblock, stop, think. Okay, we have a problem, let's solve it. That's what we're here to do, we're engineers, we're here to solve problems. We're not here to blame people and waste time, we're here to assess the problem, understand the problem, and solve it.
As we're reevaluating our lives and how our whole Capstone experience has gone so far, we took a step back, thought about what are the things that could be going wrong. So how do we debug this problem?
And so we had to do a number of debugging and go down and find out what the actual issue was. After doing so, we found it was just some integration aspects where hardware and software were on different pages on which pins were going to be utilized. After fixing those issues,
we ran it again, and finally it woke up and we were able to send and receive packets between the TSat. And that was definitely one of the best experiences of DVDT's careers.
Everything worked, and that was probably the greatest moment in our career, even with all the final testing, because it was our first design that we built and started from scratch and had our system working as real engineers.
Anytime we had a great accomplishment or we just simply needed a break, one of our favorite stress relievers was to go play spike ball. This was very fun and a great way for some team bonding.
Nobody makes me bleed my own blood. Oh! Yeah! Yeah!
One of the great things about Capstone is that you get to regularly share your project with an audience. And so we have meetings every week, so we have to present this to our customer. We have presentations, we have competitions. We were preparing stuff to share our project pretty often. And so DVDT not only wanted to focus on making a high quality product, which is important, ultimately the most important thing, but we wanted to focus on making high quality presentations of this project. You know, we wanted to share with our customer and with the audiences, why is this project important? You know, why are we spending all these hours building this product? Why does it matter to people? As project manager, it's very important to be self-motivated in challenging your teammates and in being responsive. You're going to be getting a lot of emails. You need to answer those emails quickly. You need to make phone calls. You need to remind the team of what deliverables are coming up. You need to cast the vision to everyone regularly so that they can be interested in the project, because whenever you show interest in your project, other people will be drawn and it'll help you meet your goals.
If you expect to graduate Capstone, you're going to have to pass every single functional requirement and performance specification that you and your customer have determined that the project must have. And so in order to prove that you've met all these requirements, testing is extremely important.
Alpha worked and that was amazing, but there was a number of functional requirements that we had not met yet. So we had to go on and work on some optimization of things for our beta layout. Now, one main thing that we took away from this is that you should always lay out your board to be as close as possible to the finalized size. Now, you're always going to need to break out some pins or add a few zero-ohm jumpers to your design. But if you make your design much larger than it will be in the end, you're essentially relaying out your entire board. Then that's the main difference between hardware and software. Software, if you have to make a small revision, it's easy to just change a couple lines of code. With hardware, if you have to change a large section of the layout, you have to completely redesign and relay out your whole board.
Moving from your alpha revision to your beta revision, when you're optimizing, you're also thinking about what sort of things a test engineer is going to need as he's validating your system. If you need an analog input, you need an analog output, you need a digital input, digital output, you need to understand that your test engineer needs to test those things and make sure that you're able to create software that will allow him to accomplish those tests.
You're gonna have to find a test that verifies that you're able to meet every single one of those performance specs and functional requirements. Where it was a challenge for DVDT is that we were designing a system for low Earth orbit, yet there was no way for us to ever put our system in low Earth orbit. How do we test 250 miles line of sight, which is the distance to low Earth orbit, when the curvature of the Earth affects any line of sight distance greater than a mile? These were the types of problems that DVDT faced when designing their test plan in order to fully test every performance spec and functional requirement in order to pass Capstone. What makes our major so interesting is that we get a variety of information from all these different fields. And so I had to take what I learned from my networking and wireless courses, as well as what I learned in math and physics, and put those two together in order to create this link budget that I may have seen in a previous course, yet I had to do further research and development to make a more realistic and actual link budget that accurately showed our project.
Testing can be done in lots of different ways, but in our case we needed to do some field testing, so we had to reserve some days, some weekends to go out to the lake and to do our tests. And so, you know, we had to drive away from DVDT headquarters, out of the lab, and go put this out in the field to see if it would work.
If you haven't been out to Lake Somerville, I recommend that you go. It's actually a very beautiful place.
Picture this, 100 degree weather on a beautiful lake on top of a brand new car that's radiating heat. Dakota and I are standing, transmitting packets for our TSat.
Harsh environments, like the beating down heat on top of a car where Vince and I had to sit while the other two engineers, David and Trent, were under the shade of a nice oak tree.
On the other end, underneath a beautifully big shady tree with lawn chairs and snacks, our other teammates were sitting together with blankets and listening for packets.
But we were able to find a nice comfortable spot in that grass where we laid a blanket so that it would keep some of the bugs away. We were also fortunate enough to have a tree that gave us some shade. We had the lawn chairs and we were prepared to stay the night to test. And unlike Dakota and Vince that were stuck on pavement with the sunset in their background, me and Trent had to witness one of God's greatest gifts, and that was the sunset. And so we are extremely grateful.
So DVDT is out here at Lake Somerville doing some field testings on the TSat. Right here we have the Earth Station with David and myself, and we are receiving packets from the TSat with Dakota and Vince about a mile across the lake.
we took our system out to Lake Somerville to test at a mile and then added additional attenuation to reach up to the same types of path loss that we would see at low Earth orbit.
Doing these tests was awesome because you think, hey, we're only a mile across a lake, but really adding these attenuators, we're really simulating 250 miles away.
After Beta was ready for field testing, as a hardware engineer, I had to make a deployable system that we could use in the field and not compromise any of our electronics. I had to make our system ready and capable to withstand the harsh environments of Lake Somerville.
Have an accelerated schedule, because on the first try, you may not get it right. It took us 4 times to go out to Lake Somerville before we were confident with our results in order to give those over to our customer to prove that we were successful at our line of sight communication. And so take that into account. Always have a cushion.
Go, you ready?
Okay, 3, 2, 1. Oh my gosh, this is like on the dot. Done. Okay, y'all are gonna like this. We're gonna like this a lot. So I won't keep y'all waiting anymore. The results are negative 99, 68 were good, and 0 were bad.
I got a little higher on that one, so I'm gonna stay up a little higher above the car.
Trent, there's about 40 deer right beside us.
40 deer? GoPro that.
I'm gonna probably go try to walk up to them.
I just like to shake up the ground a little bit.
If you're gonna get injured, like at least get it on video.
You just need to shake up the ground a little bit, just throw some grass.
We were successful at proving that our system could transmit and receive packets after experiencing the same types of path losses that would be seen if it was in orbit. And so this is kind of how we took what theoretically we were designing for and showed how we were able to prove it in the real world here on planet Earth, not in orbit, that our system could effectively communicate at 250 miles. Now we went back to DVDT headquarters to do some temperature testing on our system. This is important for 2 reasons. One, our system must be able to communicate while on the high altitude balloon. We're expected to see temperatures as low as negative 45 degrees Fahrenheit, and therefore we need to prove that our system can withstand those low temperatures. Additionally, we have the performance spec that our system must be space temperature rated. So this will help us confirm and test that our system can successfully transmit at extremely low temperatures. Sometimes in missile, Dakota can get a little too hot. And so to counteract that, you just pour a little dry ice on him, he cools down, and then he's good for the rest of the day.
One of the most exciting things that DVDT did was launch the TSAT on a high altitude balloon. We went out to Hillsboro Airport to do our high altitude balloon launch, and we had an Earth station in College Station to receive packets. So that was over 100 miles away that we were transmitting packets in our test. We designed a lot of things for the balloon launch, including our payload for the TSAT, including a GoPro payload to get some footage up there close to space, and also in some tripods to mount our Yagi antennas on for pointing to receive packets from the TSAT. So there's a lot of preparation that went ahead. And the reason we knew to do all these things was because we had meetings with Michael Willett, and he, you know, guided us on what we needed to have ready for that day.
When putting together the payload for our high altitude balloon launch, we needed to make sure the structure was very sturdy and that it could withstand great forces upon takeoff and landing. To do that, we put our missile stack structure into and created a system where it was part of the TSAT frame. And then we tested it in the lab to validate that it was still working once everything was constructed.
From a software perspective, we had to add a call sign so anybody who was picking up our packets would recognize that, and so we would be legally within the FCC licensing rules. I had made a TSAT pinger, patent pending, the day before so that we could listen to packets and make sure that our TSAT was still operational.
Hey, can you pick this up and like move it out the door?
Let's go outside.
So Vince designed the TSAT pinger. Right here he put another missile stack with the DVDT comm communication. And every time it receives a good packet, the LED blinks. So this is what we'll be using when we're tracking the balloon. So as you'll see, I'll walk out here and just continue to blink. Right now, he's sending from the evaluation board right here, and I'm tracking it, not tracking it, but I'm receiving packets, and the LED is still blinking. So David and I are going to be driving around holding this out of our window of the car to see if we'll get packets from the balloon. It's a very nice design by Vince Rodriguez. Oh my gosh, there's the chopper. Get to the chopper.
So going out to Hillsboro and doing our high altitude balloon test was an amazing experience.
You can see the high altitude balloon is being filled right now with helium. We're going to be going up to 100,000 feet with the TSAT strapped to the very bottom of our payload. We have three GoPros attached to hopefully get some nice footage of at the edge of space.
Everything was going great. The payloads were all strapped and ready. It was a tad bit windy, yet we knew that we wanted to launch our system.
And you know, we had quite a scare because when we were taking off, it was really windy. And so all the payloads are kind of lined together. So as the balloon starts going off, you kind of release your payloads and everything kind of goes up.
How's the TSAT?
I'm scared.
And I had the critical payload, our TSAT. I wasn't going to let that fail. As a hardware engineer, I designed our system to withstand a lot of G-forces, a lot of rattling with our launch and landing. So I was confident in the ability.
The balloon launched and it was very exciting. The TSAT was gaining altitude.
It was an insane experience. You know, and it was super stressful as well. Because you know, you think, man, you know, once you know you let it go in the air, there's nothing you can do. You know, it's that either gonna work or it's not gonna work. Everybody was like, oh no, I hope it's still working. We turn around and Trent says,
we're getting packets.
And everybody was ecstatic.
Within 10 minutes, we got a call from T-Star. We're getting packets. It was very exciting to see that the system was already working. Even it was transmitting literally through the horizon. And so it was awesome to see that our system was working. So from there, we had to drive and track this balloon. We had a tracking system on there that could show us where the balloon was, what altitude it was at.
We're currently at 30,000 feet over Waxahachie.
And so we just hung out and we drove underneath the balloon, even though it was thousands of feet above us. We were tracking it and following it and getting ready for it to pop and for its descent. The balloon was at a standstill. It just kept gaining altitude in one position, so we kind of stopped there at a McDonald's and just waited for it to pop. We were up above 99% of the Earth's atmosphere, so we were almost in space. We were seeing extreme temperatures, and we were sending data across actual Earth's atmosphere. And so it was a great test to see our TSAT in this environment and to see if this is going to work.
Oh!
It took a while to find the system, but with some of Michael Wilt's tracking system, he was able to find it. And we had a little bit of a problem because the TSAT landed in a pasture full of steer. We finally got in there and picked it up, and everything was still functional. And so it was an awesome test to see the TSAT worked across Earth's atmosphere in extreme temperatures. It was very exciting. We finished the testing and it was getting ready for us to close out this project. So we got ready for our final presentation, which was really easy because we have been giving presentations all semester long. And so this project just came naturally out of us. And it was nice that we had all these materials ready for that. And going into the final demo, we just, you know, made sure that we could show the customer that, you know, all these requirements are being met that we said the system was being capable of doing. So we had to show all the different tests we did, you know, like at Lake Somerville, we showed a video that showed, you know, how we did all this attenuation to show that it can transmit long distances. And we had data sheets to show we're meeting these requirements like space temperatures. And, you know, all those requirements you made, just you have to show a way that that was met to the customer. Watching our customer and our advisor sign off on our project was one of the most satisfying feelings because we made a product that met the requirements we set for our customer. And we gave it to him. And we knew that, you know, all of these months that we've worked on this and all the advisors that helped us, well, we finally accomplished the goal that is going towards the idea of commercializing low Earth orbit and making space exploration more accessible. It's one of an awesome feeling to see that we did it as a team and we did it with all the help of our advisors. Capstone was an amazing experience for DVDT, and we came into it wanting that. We came in wanting to learn a lot about ourselves, learn about how to work in a team, how to solve problems, and we learned all of that and more. It's important to embrace that and just learn as much as you can in the Capstone experience, and it's really going to prepare you for a career and teach you a lot of lessons that will be very helpful in your future. Capstone is done, and we couldn't have felt any better about it.
Everyone's expectation is that DVDT would be a leader in Capstone, if not just for your own group, but overall. You've exceeded those expectations.
The sun may be setting for DVDT, and although this is the end of one chapter of our lives, I have great confidence that we will all rise again.
DVDT might be over for now, but just wait. There's going to be a sequel.